Darn it. true.
Thank you.
Please stand. With faith in Jesus Christ, to receive the body of our sister Barbara for burial. Our sister was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let's therefore with confidence pray to God and Heavenly Father to give us life, that He will raise her to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, remember for you this day our sister Barbara. We thank you for giving her to us, her family and friends, the known and loved companion on our earthly pilgrimage. You have brought this compassion to console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life. Serve in quiet confidence in your continue our course on earth, until by your call we unite with those who have gone before. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The opening hymn, number 497, Blessed Assurance, Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Almighty God, remember before you today your servant Barbara. I pray that having opened to her the gates of larger life, you'll receive her more and more into your joyful service. That all who serve you in the past, she may share the eternal victory of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the ministry of the word. We have the first reading.
Okay, the first reading is taken from the book of Ecclesiastes, 3, 1 through 12. It was to be done by my cousin Sean, but he couldn't make it, so I'm pinch hitting for it. For everything there is a season, and for every time, for every matter under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to sue, a time to keep silent, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future in their minds. Yet they cannot find out what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there's nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as they live now.
Psalm 121.
Thank you.
kindly be seated for the second reading.
Always eating. However, that did not mean that every single meal translated into her cooking it for us. Only my father warranted that, you know, status of cooking every, or her providing the meal every day. You know, when, so I stayed a couple of days over at my aunt Myrtle over there, and she asked me a question. She said, can you cook? And I'm like, oh yes, I can cook. I can cook actually very well, because I had to do it to survive at home, right? I went, so I'll give an example. So breakfast and making lunch for school was my thing. So once, for all my friends at school at St. Boniface, they all brought their lunch to school, my group of 10 friends of us. But they all were surprised at what they had for lunch that day. I wasn't, because I got up in the morning and I made breakfast and I made that lunch, so I knew what was in that pack. So I went to my mother and I explained to her that all my friends are surprised by the lunch they have, and I want to be surprised too. So she just looked at me, straight in the eye, and said, close your eyes and make your lunch, then you'll be surprised. You know, I'm like, so there were none of these gender roles defining my house. And for goodness sake, I have four sisters. If anybody should have these gender roles, it should be me. But it wasn't. We all had to learn to clean, cook, iron, press, and all of those things. So keeping the food theme, I once, you know, told my mom that, you know, for the last couple of weeks, you know, the food that you've been preparing was not up to your usual standard. You kind of need to jazz it up a bit. She didn't say anything to me. Nothing. Zero. However, for the next 5 days, there was absolutely no food prepared for me. For 5 days. So I kind of learned my lesson well, right? It is, you've got to think before you speak and understand the ramifications and know there will be consequences to the things you do. So then, when I went off to college and school, you know, I was able to depend on my mother to marshal the network in New York City, to help me out. So that first semester was great. It was this sense of freedom, unabridged freedom, you know. So I could remember telling my mom on the phone that I was going to get some piercings and some tattoos. And I know she was uber conservative about those things, and she would not actually approve of those. However, she was 3,000 miles away. How was she going to stop me? So as I said that, she actually said something to me. Okay then, pay your own tuition. And I was like, at that point, I really understood the term leverage, right? So I had to pack up. And I was trying to backpedal and says, oh, no, I wasn't doing that, I was joking. She's like, come home, let me check you. So I had to pack up, get on the plane, fly home. I had to do that periodically, you know, for my mom to check. So I actually started working, you know, for a very conservative British company. Took me all over the world, you know, but at that time when I got up, I says, as soon as I graduate, I'm going to get my stuff. But it never worked out because of the role I had back in those days, what people expected of me. So compromise at that time, you know, was not bad for me. Kind of worked out really good for me. I also had, those have the lesson of people do not always say the things that they mean, and you have to work it out for it. For example, what is that? So if you say, one of these days, it produces hope for everyone, right? Not that my mother said one of these days. One of these days means it will never happen, right? So you have to kind of read through these lines and understand, you know, what's kind of going on in there. I also had the pleasure to witness the handoff from, you know, a disciplinarian mother to grandmother. I remember when I was here visiting once, when my older daughter was almost three, you know, my wife and I had pretty you know, admonish her fully. You couldn't get something. Don't even know where it was anymore. And immediately she screamed like a banshee, ran out of our room, ran right into my parents' room. She stayed there for about 20 minutes and then came back smiling. I turned to my wife and I was like, what just happened there? And up to this day, we have no idea what happened in that room. But it was clear that it was a different role as a grandmother from that as a parent. And the parenting was now for me, not for her. But on a side note, you know, I always tell people, grandparents are uncontrollable. You just have to let them do what they want. You know, there's nothing that you can tell them. My mother had an uncanny ability to be there for people, allowing them to speak what's on their mind, speak what's on their heart, and counsel them and provide that level of understanding for them. You know, looking back, I'm always shocked and awe at the sheer amount of people who were coming to our house on a daily basis. But even more so, you know, with a father of teens, I was like, how did she feed all of these people, you know, coming into our place? Because she was always cooking food for my friends and my cousin's friends, you know, my sister's friends and all everyone that's come around. When I started this conversation, it was a little known about how I was a Boy Scout and how I quit Boy Scouts. My mother allowed me to quit the Boy Scout troop, but there's a lot of things that she never, ever allowed me to give up. So one of those was education. And every time there were special lessons offered at school, you know, I was signed up for it. I remember once, I actually decided, yeah, I'm not going to go to those lessons that Mr. Beng was offering, you know, preparing for the 11 plus. But somehow that day, my mother happened to stop by the school, which, you know, Grace and Monica says they're really, I don't know why that happened. And my friends and I were up there playing, and she's like, weren't you supposed to be in lessons? And immediately, my entire friend group, all 10 of us, signed up for lessons, and we were in there. The fear was in them, and they all signed up, you know, so we did that. Another was my religious education. Like, in this church, you know, coming here, now being confirmed, learning all the creeds, learning all the catechisms, was something that she really wanted us to do. And at that time when I got confirmed, it was a busy time for me, you know, because I was preparing for the 11 plus exam, I was doing confirmation classes, you know, I was going to lessons to prep for the exam, so every day was busy. But she insisted, like, no, you have to go to church, you have to do these things, because you have to have this fundamental belief and understood that and build the foundations. To that fact, one of the things through this is like, why are we here today? Like, we are here today in this church because she understood that earthly preparation really matters. But there was something more important, and that was your preparation for eternity. All of the sounds, all of the readings, everything that you're hearing today, you know, is about that, about us looking ahead. And one of the things I want to end with by saying is that I want you to take another look at the sounds that we're singing, at that scripture I read earlier, and all of those, you know, to understand where you are and where your position is as you come to Christ. If you want to honor Barbara Boyce, I will give you this last thing to say. Connect with your community. Find someone to mentor and live the gospel that you should. Thank you.
The hymn 236, 236. First, let me take the opportunity this morning to extend to the family and the friends of our sister Barbara and Lucille Boyce in New Chester our sincere condolences. I do so on behalf of the congregation at St. Peter's and on my own behalf. As we meet to give God thanks and praise for her life, her contribution to society, and her contribution to church and family, we pray for God's blessings on you as you go through this period of mourning. We pray that God will continue to bless you, and God will continue to work in your lives as you miss and adjust during this period of loss. I speak in the name of God, Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Words from St. John's Gospel, the 2nd chapter, the 7th verse. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some and take it to the chief's show." Fill the jars with water. We're told simply empty vessels make most noise. And today we think about filling the jars, making a difference, moving from the emptiness of the jars and filling them to the brim. We, as we pay tribute to our sister Barbara, we join with you as, and especially Eulogius, the son, who spoke of her and the importance of coming to church within the context of the family. And he identified scouts and also identified the church. I dare say I think that the church, the scouts will be here at St. Peter's. But the importance for her to be part of the church and for her family to be part of the church. When I entered the church this morning, four young ladies looked at me and they spoke to me in familiar terms, in a familiar way. And they reminded me, I know I definitely spoke too, but they reminded me, four of them reminded me, "You prepared for confirmation." And they spoke not of just about them and their memories, but they spoke of Barbara, who insisted that her grands come to be confirmed in this church. And they say, "You all have a responsibility of passing on that to your children and your children's children." But the blessing of God in the life of God makes a difference to us. That we come with an important trait in our lives. God who makes that difference. And obedience to God. And the text this morning taken from John chapter 2, which is part of the event that came in Galilee. Then we're told that his mother came to him, the mother of Jesus came to him and said, "If they have no wine," that the wine was, had run out. They'd come to a desperate situation in the ceremony. Things weren't going as expected. Someone had made a big mistake in catering. And it's always an awful feeling when we make mistakes when we cater. When things run out and we seem as though that we're cheap or that we have not planned properly. And she turns to her son to alleviate this disaster, to remove this disaster, to give them a sense of hope, a sense of triumph, to act in the situation. And Jesus' words to her were, as you might consider, very harsh words. If you think of referring to his mother as a woman, what has that to do with me? But someone who places her confidence in her son. She places her confidence in the one who is there, the one she has brought up, the one that she suffered so much for. The one who has been there for her so far in her life. Who continue to be there in her life throughout. Who is, as we parted this world, he said to the beloved disciple and to her from the cross, "Woman, behold thy son, and son, behold thy mother." He left each other in a caring relationship, to look after each other, to love one each other. And at this point, we think about that family life which Jesus generated and Jesus supported as he commended them to each other. But a woman who, in this situation, turns to her son. And her own, that very special relationship between mothers and their children, especially their sons. She looked at him and he questioned what it has to do with him or what it has to do with her. He was probably saying that you should mind your own business. Sometimes we're told to mind our own business. And Jesus, who is there? And The mother was saying, whatever he says to you, do it. And Jesus breaks his silence. And he simply says to the servants, those who were working at the wedding, whatever he says to you, do it. And he says to them, fill the jars with water. Fill them with water. And we think about the psalm which says, fill my cup and let it overflow. We talk of being filled with the Holy Spirit. God fills us in our lives. He fills us with the Spirit. We're full of the Spirit. We're full of joy. We're full of hope. We're full of the right consideration of God, the blessing of God. God who fills our lives. He doesn't leave us to live empty lives or meaningless lives. But he gives us meaningful life. He gives us purposeful life. And God who directs in Jesus, who directs the servants at that feast to fill the jars of water. And St. John is particularly in telling us in detail about this feast, about those 6 jars which were there for the Jewish rites of purification. They were not just earthen vessels, but they were made of stone. And they were there for the ritual washing of hands. And they were empty. And then Jesus commands the servants to fill the jars with water. It is by obedience and through obedience. Where Mary says to them, whatever he says to you, do it. And then they respond by filling the jars with water. And then he says, most important of all, drunk some. Drunk some, and again, instructions which are given. Take it to destroy the feast. And when he tasted it, he realized something had happened. We don't know at what time the miracle took place, but God in Christ Jesus made a difference, and he makes a difference today in your life, and in our life, God makes a difference. Loss of mother, loss of wife, loss of grandparent, it is a critical time in life. But she would have taught you and shown you obedience. When she sent you off to scout, when she sent you off to church, when she sent you off to some school or confirmation class, to be involved, to be a part of what is happening. She would have given you that sense of discipline. She called on us all and you all to listen to what she was saying and to follow the instructions, education that we speak about and that the Eulogist spoke about in his tribute. That he spoke about listening and learning in class. The importance of listening, not only to what is being said to us by those around us, but also by listening to the still, small voice of God which makes a difference. And Jesus says to the workers, to the servants, I hate using the word servant, it's one of those funny words that carries back into slavery. My first thought of the word is those who are working, those who are engaged at working at the feast. Those of you who work in the hotel and catering in the hotel, you should know that that is an important task. It's almost a difficult task. An impossible task as you move around on your feet throughout the night or the day as you eventually have to clean up afterwards. But Jesus says to them, fill the jars with water. He doesn't ask them to do something which is impossible. He doesn't ask them to do something which is awful or something which is not legal or something which is illegal. He offers them and calls on them to listen first of all, but then to fill the jars with water, to go through the process of filling the jars with water. And in our time, we think of pushing them on the pipe or pushing them towards the little holes to fill them with water. But probably the task of moving water from one place to another, distributing the water as they shared it between these 6 jars. I dare say, let me hear about 6 jars. Normal reading in scripture, we hear about 7 as that critical number. Only 6. And perhaps Jesus is saying, John is saying something very special to us as he identifies these 6 jars. Because in John's gospel, there are only 6 signs or 6 miracles. And this is the first of the 6 miracles. And probably the 6 jars point towards the 6 signs that Jesus will do in this gospel. And this one where by obedience, where he causes a change in what is happening. He moves the incident from despair to the incident of a place of joy. As the show says, everyone who's at this circumstance, that they keep the good wine until last and they serve the bad wine first. But this individual, this very woman, served the best wine first. A God who calls on us as a people to be attentive to what is going on, to be able to follow instructions. And listening to what has gone on in the church this morning, we hear about that. We hear the message of parent, a mother, a wife, saying to those committed to her charge to listen carefully. Saying to them, and she also listened carefully. She listened to her son who said, "Let you criticize the wheels," and she responded. She listened to you and what you were saying. And she called on you also to listen. And she also called obedience. Obedience in this life. And we live in an age where disobedience triumphs. Disobedience is one of the critical things, one of the important things, or one of the things that happen in this life. And God calls us to be obedient. Appearance taught you obedience. I remember being challenged by the girls who came to confirmation class, but something went on in their lives, something happened in their lives. And they were able to make reference to that this morning as I came in as a priest to do this service for them this morning. We give God thanks for that Christian instruction. The Christian example and instruction which was passed on to Barbara by her parents, by the family. And which she in turn has passed on to you, her children and her grandchildren. We call on you to be able to respond to God's love and God's care. To emphasize to you, survival is our belief and trusting in God. I recognize that God can change things in our lives. God can transform things in our lives. That God, as the psalmist says, is our refuge and our strength, and a very present help in time of trouble. And to him we turn as children, grandchildren, husband, and family, and friends. We turn to him because he is able to help you more than anything else in this world as you mourn the loss of a loving grandparent, a loving mother, a loving wife. And we thank Almighty God for her witness and presence, not only in our church, but in your lives. We pray that this God in Christ Jesus will grant to her eternal rest. Rest, eternal grant to her, O Lord, that let perpetual shine upon her. May her soul and all souls be given to the comfort and mercy of God. Rest in peace. Amen. The hymn number 407, As the Deer Pants.
and I am life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Barbara and dry the tears of those who weep. Hear us, Lord. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. Hear us, Lord. You raised the dead to life. Raise our sister to eternal life. Hear us, Lord. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister to the joys of heaven. Hear us, Lord. Our sister was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give her fellowship with all your saints. Hear us, Lord. She was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, comfort us in the sorrow at the death of our sister. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope.
Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our sister Barbara, who was reborn by water and spirit in holy baptism. Grant that her death may recall to us your victory over death, and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you led the way, and may you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages. Amen. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant and your saints. Their sorrow and pain are no more, never sighing, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind, and we are mortal from which birth and to earth shall return. For so did you ordain and create me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust. We think that the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant and your saints. Their sorrow and pain are no more, never sighing, but life.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Our Father,
let us commend our sister Barbara to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. You lift your servant Barbara, our sovereign Lord Christ, from our evil, and set her free from earth of bondage, that she may rest in all your saints in eternal habitations, that the Father and the Holy Spirit may live and reign, one God, forever and ever. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Barbara, acknowledging how we beseech your sheep of good fold, and now your own flock. A sinner of the Holy Redeemer. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and in the glorious company of the saints in life. Amen. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord, let thy perpetual shine upon her. Let her soul and all souls be given to the Father, for the mercy of God, rest in peace. The hymn number 427, 427.
Thank you.
Dumbly down death by death. Have given life and love and suffering. The Son of Exodus is gloriously risen. Given life to those who suffer in darkness. And in the shadow of death. The Lord who they was from the way of peace, and have taken away the sin of the world. Christ will open the kingdom of heaven to all who believe in his name. Come on, bless you, my Father. And let the kingdom be here for you.
And I'm coming in the market to see her. I bring her into the holy city, Jerusalem. Rest eternal blood unto her, O Lord. Then so, Lord, for the name of the Father, the blessed of God, rest in me.